Nick, just quickly, I mean, you've been a visiting scholar on the ground in Europe now for about 3 months. How prominent in other countries beyond the UK is the immigration issue?
It is the number one issue, Peter. It is the proxy for another issue, which is just patriotism. People want a sense of national identity, a sense of cultural identity, which has been eroded by the European Union's policies, the idea of mass immigration, the idea that diversity in itself is somehow a good thing. People are sick of that, and that is what the conservative right is coming together over now in Europe with the formation of a new group in the European Parliament, Patriots for Europe. They are clearly identifying and articulating now that that is the issue. It is patriotism, it is support for one's country, and the ability to control who comes across your borders. Nobody at the elite level is taking any notice of that, but they're going to have to wake up soon because this pressure won't go away.
Well, let's go to some issues closer to home. New South Wales Premier Chris Minns has ordered a very swift return to the office for government workers, essentially putting an end to working from home with just 1 day's notice. He says it'll help the CBD get back on its feet. At the same time, the Victorian government's using it as a bit of a recruitment drive, saying if you want to work from home, come to the utopia of Victoria. Well, I don't know about utopia, Cam. I tell you, you know, the more I see of Chris Minns, the more that a Liberal like me could be tempted to vote for him. Some say this is going to backfire for him because a lot of the departments have downsized. They don't actually have the desk space for these workers. But he's determined to boost productivity, and I say all credit to him.
That's the word, Peter. The P word is productivity. There's a real economic reason why the Premier wants to get people back to the office, because you look at the numbers, productivity, that's when you particularly break it down to say the amount of output or the amount of work you do in an hour. When everyone got sent home at the beginning of COVID, for the first 3 months, it shot up because people thought, how good is this? I can work from the couch, I can work from the balcony or the backyard. And then everybody did it for a while and productivity went through the floor, and it's pretty much stayed that way ever since. So the economic argument, it does stack up to try and get people back into the office. And it's good for businesses in the CBD too. As an ex-Sydney sider, I can tell you there's not a great deal of life in the CBD anymore. So I think, Peter, look, there's not a lot of work from home in industries like ours. I would probably have Sky News on at home anyway. But for a lot of people, if you're in any other job, you'd probably have the Olympics on, make a cup of tea every hour. Fridays, I'd work from the pub. So, look, I think this sort of thing does make a lot of sense.
I might add, though, in Canberra, you've got some departments, Tony Burke's old employment department, 70% of workers work from home. And there it's in EBAs that they can work from home full time, so 5 days a week. So that is extraordinary. Let's hope they have a wake up in Canberra as well. Let's go to Queensland. Stephen Miles, the Premier up there, is attempting to buy off voters, we know, with these 50% public transport fares. But his latest bit of nonsense, it's grabbing headlines today, the Premier announcing $36 million to buy and run 12 state-owned petrol stations. Now, it's not backed by modelling or research. Experts say this is a crazy idea. The LNP, Nick, have labelled it the dumbest policy by far from a Queensland Premier. Hard to disagree.
It is, Peter. And look, I'm in Tirana, the capital of Albania, which they tried this experiment for about half a century, in which the government owned and ran everything, and it was a disaster. And I reckon if you went and asked people on the streets of Tirana what they thought of this policy, they'd think that Queensland had gone completely batty. These things are not done well by government. And I can imagine what a state-run petrol station will be like, by the way. There'll be a massive long queue. It'll be running out of unleaded fuel every other day and would have too much diesel. And you wouldn't be able to buy all the chocolates and ice cream and everything you want. That's what a state-run petrol station would look like. Get it. This is none of the businesses of the state to do stuff like that. And it won't help petrol prices at all. The best thing for petrol prices is free market competition.
Let's go back to the issue of Makarrata. The Prime Minister still copping a backlash over mixed messaging over the weekend. Aboriginal leaders are warning the Prime Minister he risks misleading the public if he walks away from establishing a Makarrata Commission. I might add, all the money's still in the budget. His public servants down at Prime Minister and Cabinet, they're still working on it, but he's telling us it's now being shelved. if he wins the election, it will happen. So make no bones about that. But in Queensland, Cam, there's been a development there about a controversial Aboriginal land transfer. This is in relation to a little town that basically most of their land will be handed over to a local First Nations corporation. What can you tell us?
Yeah, I know you've been on top of this issue for many months now, Peter, as it's developed. This land dispute really between the local community, the government, also the Indigenous groups in the region about the transfer of this land. Some say that as much as 90% of the town could be handed over. The council disputes that figure. But this all comes back to the theme. I mean, I've just come back from the Garma Festival, Peter, in northeast Arnhem Land, where one of the themes of that festival was about this shared decision-making between local Indigenous communities, between governments and communities. And if any one of those is left out, that's where things fall apart. You now have, in this case, to try and sort it all out, the state ombudsman has been brought in to go through the paperwork and perhaps be involved in a final decision being made. But it kind of comes back to that central point. The community says they weren't consulted on this, and now they're rebelling against the decision. I feel that if that is the case, well, you should have just gone back and got everyone on the same page, and then perhaps you could have worked out a way of getting a solution. But it appears if that hasn't happened here, that seems to be the root of where the problems come from. So now the state ombudsman is coming in to try and sort it out, and it looks like it's only going to get messier from here, Peter.
Deals in secret that are done are never good deals for taxpayers, let me tell you. Thank you, gents, Cam and Nick.